May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be able to complete this month of Ramadan with his pleasure, to benefit ourselves, to become better people who can serve communities wherever we can find them and be the best representative to Islam, inshallah. This discussion we're going to have today is going to be a continuation from yesterday when we spoke to Sister Sakina, and it was really fruitful. Many people have not known her before, got to know her, and many people did not know the importance of poetry, especially when they see a lot of Nasheed groups singing across the world. They don't realize that Nasheed has a place and poetry has a great place in the life of the human being. Today, our subject is being chosen by a friend of mine, a brother, mashallah, who's done a lot of good, and he will tell you all that himself, what he does. And his name is Dr. Allam. And Allam is somebody who came from Sudan and continued education in this country to a high level. And mashallah, he's now leading in one of the universities and lecturing and doing a lot of programs across the world through an organization that he has established called Sudan Knowledge. And I will wish a lot of people will enter into Sudan Knowledge website and look to see what this man is really doing. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Allam.
عليكم السلام شيخ بابكر. عليكم السلام, رمضان كريم.
كيف حالك سيدي؟ ان شاء الله طيب, احوالك اخبارك؟
الحمد لله والله يا اخي, ان شاء الله يجزيك كل خير.
I'm so grateful to have you with me today. I am so appreciative of what you do. But before we get into the discussion and the subject you talked about and you want to discuss with me, I would like you please to give a brief description of your life. Where did you grow? Because it's nice to hear it from the person himself. And how did you come to this country? And what did you do since you came? Just studying and then just becoming a lecturer? Maybe you did a lot of other things. And what about your family? Have you got a family? Have you got children? And how is life for you and your family in this country, inshallah?
Thank you very much, Sheikh Babikir. Shukran jazeera, Sheikh Babikir. Ramadan Kareem. I take this opportunity to wish everyone who is watching us or who they will watch us back, Ramadan Kareem. I hope, inshallah, Rabbana give the blessing of everyone of this great month. And also, it's a great honor and privilege, Sheikh Babikir, to be with you on a platform. And when I had the privilege or the honor of the invitation from Amina, I didn't know what to do because I was always find you quite an inspirational and intelligent person I have never met before. So it's very difficult to have a conversation with someone, he knows things, even your own specialty, better than you. So I wasn't quite sure what the topic will be, but just to answer your first question, as you said, I born in Sudan, and I born in those from Sudan, they know it is called Madani or Wad Madani. We have two versions. I studied in Sudan until I finished university in Khartoum, and I came to this country to do a master degree at the Royal Agricultural. At the time I came, it was the Royal Agricultural College, but many years ago it became the Royal Agricultural University. And I was just lucky when I applied, I found they have a scholarship. I was very keen to link agriculture with business. And at that time, when I was looking for programs, I found that was the only program in the United Kingdom at that time, 1996, which connect agriculture and business. Not so sure. The master I did was MBA in agribusiness. Mm. And the college, I didn't know much until I applied and I got the scholarship, which was partial scholarship. So I didn't come on a full scholarship, but I didn't know this is a college which is the president of the college or the patronage of the college is the queen herself. And the president is Prince Charles. So I didn't know it's a real royal college. Mm. And when I came, I found it is sitting out of Oxford near Swindon. It's just in between Swindon, Siren Sister. It's called that area is quite more of a village countryside. Mm. But we were like 30 minutes from Oxford, from Swindon, from Bristol, from Gloucester, from Cheltenham. It was just sitting there in that, in the outside. I met people who are very rich. I met people who are normal people, and I met people who are very, they coming from big farming families in Africa or in Zimbabwe and so on. I met people whom they, when they invited me for dinner in their places, very rich, big families. So it was a big shock for me when I came to this country to go to houses really like palaces. So many people I now talk to them, they have never seen these big houses or big families. So when we used to go and they were telling us that you have it like a tour in the house, this is all in that area. And one of the person who died now, who was with us in the same MBA, his son, were the friends of the two princes, Harry and William, because that's their area, you know, Gloucestershire. And I remember we have, that's the first time to expose to the royal, or to see what's royal mean. But then after I finished my master, I went to Scotland, to Edinburgh, and I did my PhD in economics. And I was very keen to, or what I specialized in quickly was, I did my PhD at the School of Economics and Accounting, and it was focusing on technology transfer, particularly a technology gap between the developed countries and developing countries. So technology produced in the developed countries like UK, when you, and there's a gap with the technology in Sudan or in developing countries. But what I managed in my PhD to find is that there is a gap between, say, Oxford or the UK and Sudan, as an example, but I discovered there's another gap within Sudan. So we it was an additional technological gap. So we said, if you are, want to measure the gap between technology in the developed and the developing, you need to measure between the developed and developing, and then you need to add the small additional gap within the developing countries. So in simple terms, the farmer in the UK produce more than the farmer in Africa. But within Africa itself, there's a difference, there's a gap in the productivity between the research produced by universities and research institutions and the actual rural farmer in the rural villages. So the gap is actually, when you do that, is quite bigger than I expected. I also specialize in marketing. I'm a charter marketer. And then I spent 4 years in the University of East London. Then I went 15 years to the University of Sussex. Then I came back to the University of East London. During this period, the organization you referred to it, alhamdulillah, I managed to found it in 2008, which is called the International Diaspora Project. We then, it got predominantly named as Sudan Knowledge because where I come from, where most of the people will try this on them, particularly the doctors were Sudanese, but it's actually an organization is spreading or helping to identify the benefits, the diaspora, like myself, Sudanese British, or Jamaican British, or Syrian British, or Jamaican American, and so on, who can transfer knowledge and technology to their home countries with the advantage of knowing the culture of those countries.
Yeah.
What I am more known for, or is maybe specialized for, is when I got that professorship from Brighton University, and then East London. It's called knowledge management and sustainable development. So all my work is to connect knowledge management or managing knowledge with sustainable development. And just one thing here: in 1999, when we start working on founding the World Association for Sustainable Development. The idea was that sustainable development is a much bigger concept than just the environment or climate change. It involved behavior, politics, and so on. So that's what I have been doing over the last, 20-something years.
Alhamdulillah. That's really fantastic. Now, the subject you wanted to talk about today, could you just give us a brief indication to what the subject is and why did you choose this subject?
When I have been approached to think of a subject which it can be a good conversation with a person like yourself, I try to search of a subject or a topic that's it's not being surfaced or no one really talked too much about it. And I realize while we have been talking, there is a massive, unlimited, everything, every aspect of COVID-19 is being talked about. But I realize there is one important aspect of COVID-19 we didn't talk about it much, which is positive lessons learned. And I insist on the word positive because there are positives. Positives, lessons learned from this pandemic or this COVID-19. And interestingly, from last year, when I was been following these issues of COVID, we're trying to do as many as possible of the work while people are locked down. Some other people have written, and I start thinking about, are there any lessons we can learn from COVID? Are there any positives? And I know many people of those who are watching or your viewers now, they will be surprised to see that it's not only me, there's many other people as well talking about positive lessons. Then the word positive is really important here, because myself and others, we found that there's so many positives despite all the seriousness and this, if you like, crisis and catastrophic pandemic. Inshallah, God will get us out of this as soon as possible. But there are so many positive things we have learned, but we didn't realize we have learned them. And I thought that might be a very good topic to have a conversation with someone like you. So, because there is lots of inspirational and spiritual part of it, really, of what I'm going to try to discuss with you.
جزاك الله خير. To be honest with you, يعني it has been a very strange time since last year. I remember I went in December. I was not last year December. I think December 2019. I was in Sudan, and then it was Eid al-Adha, and I had Eid al-Adha, and then I came back at the beginning of 2020 January. When I arrived back, I remember we had a chat between me and you in the telephone, and then I went to Morocco. We did a retreat there with Amina and her guest. When I came back at the end of February, I decided then to stay at home, not to leave. Because what really alarmed me, for the first time in the history of my life that I lived, I had never seen people most worried about anything but what they are seeing in front of them. And people are beginning to talk about this new disease that's coming. The world has always been tested. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the test so that people can better themselves. People that can move away from selfishness to become more productive, even within their own families and neighborhood and communities. Forget about the larger world and society. So I remember from the mid of March 2020, I stayed at home. And then suddenly by the end of March, government across the world stopped everything. No flight, no going out, no shopping, no working. Everybody was sitting. And government were beginning to think of something. In the midst of this, you have got two camps. There is one camp of people who were really frightened and worried, and they don't know what to do. And there are people who were dismissing it right out. There's nothing like that. As if to say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot test the world. This is not the first pandemic the world goes through. In 1923, we had the big flu in Spain that killed millions of people. And many times we have cholera, we have, and in the last maybe 5 years in Africa, there were many different viruses that killed people, like Ebola and other things. So there are lessons for me personally that I have learned. And to be honest with you, Professor, one of the first lessons that I have learned that we should never, never take things for granted. Why I'm saying this? People began to neglect their purpose of living their life. How? For example, as an imam or a sheikh in the masjid, or when I'm giving talk, people come to me. Can you believe the world has reached a position families are not functioning? Children are not talking to their parents. Parents are creating disputes with their relatives and making the children confused. Parents are asking the children to be strict in their religion, and the parents are not strict. And I can give many other examples. So everything is upside down. And everybody, when you ask them, I don't have time. The question for me and for everybody else, how many hours in the day? There are 24 hours, yes. We all have 24 hours. If the doctor is asking us to sleep for 8 hours, and we do. If the workplace is asking us to work for 8 hours, and we do. There is another 8 hours. What do we do in the third 8 hours? If we are not working or we are not sleeping. This is where I began to think seriously, we are neither worshipping Allah by rituals that He has instructed, like extra salah, extra fasting, and extra activities, okay, for ourselves, like dhikr, or not even socializing in doing the ibadah in their interaction. الدين المعاملة, the Prophet said, religion is interaction. We're not going out and helping people and supporting people and visiting people. Do you know that Rasulullah SAW says, when you visit the sick, okay, you will find Allah there before you, because Allah is with the person who's sick. Okay, so we don't do that. When you go and visit a grave, you're not just reminding yourself of your death to come, but you are benefiting all those people in the graveyard because you are coming and reading for them. Okay, Rasulullah says, I have forbidden you from visiting the grave, but now I'm allowing you. Go and visit them for many good reasons. Another thing you have to realize as well, this lockdown, last year, we did not, for the first time, pray our Jum'ah prayer in the masjid. It is shocking for, I had never, ever in my life, since I can know, I never went to Jum'ah, only when they stopped it. Ramadan, no salah in the masjid, and no taraweeh, no khatm al-Quran, no imam to come to recite for us like the normal thing. Then also, Hajj, there was no Hajj. I go to Umrah every Ramadan, but last year, no Umrah, no Hajj, and no traveling, just locked. When it was eased by Eid al-Adha and we went out to pray Salatul Eid, and then people began to take seriously the matter, those who are wise enough to understand there's a problem, subhanallah, then it daunted in many people, this test we can pass, but we need to know one thing. What benefit did we get out of it? For me, I got time with my family. I travel a lot. I'm hardly at home. First time in my life, I'm sitting at home. I had never traveled anywhere. Okay, not even in London. I'm just sitting at home. After the lockdown, it was eased. I started going out for shopping once a week. That's it. When Jum'ah is open, I go and lead my Jum'ah and come back. Second thing I benefited from, that I'm sitting at home with my laptop, like you see me now, and I could record, and you did with me last Ramadan, program for children at assemblies, program for adults, helping other people by giving talk to them. It gave me, before I used to refuse people, I haven't got time because I can't do too many talks because I need to travel. It wastes time, especially when people invite me abroad or in other cities. But now it is open. It is beautiful. It is fantastic. So this is the benefit that I have got. And most important, I could delve in my library and my books. Some of them I had never opened for years, but now I could every day, mashallah, enjoying myself opening it. And I'm sure you have the same, Dr. Alam, to speak about in regard of the benefit that we have got in this time when we are locked down.
Well, that's a very nice start, Sheikh Babakir. In the same line of what you have just mentioned, Sheikh Babakir, I think I tried to put them in an order of 1, 2, 3, or any way they can be more meaningful. But I can see that you already summarized the key benefit. I think I agree with you totally. But the way I put them also, I think I may be wrong, but many people, during my conversation with many people last year, I think many people will tell you, Sheikh, people during this COVID-19 lockdown, they managed to understand better the true meaning of life. And I know Allah this Allah. Is quite a big statement to make, but many people, I think, if I can conclude what they are trying to say, we now better understand the real meaning of life. What does that mean? We understand life is not just about us doing things. It's not like about me becoming a lecturer or teaching, or I want to make money, or I want to buy a flat, or I want to do business. But life is really about other things, which is very important part of the meaning of human being. Is I think the word of being is quite an important word. We didn't realize or understand it fully. It is our life. Our life is about being. It's not about just doing things and so on. Because if you look at the last year, we start to realize It's all about well-being. Many psychiatrists, many doctors, they will talk about mental health and well-being during this part.
Yes.
The being part is what you just referred to it, the family time. People didn't understand the being, enjoying life. Life is not just about running in the tube all the way, running, just coming home to have a quick shower and then sleep, go to the next day. But it's about that, the word being, human being, is about really sitting down, reflect with yourself, study like you have just said, and so on and so on. And I think also many of us understood much better life is not about money. And I know many people have said this in the past, but COVID told us clearly, COVID did not stop at anyone's doors who is very rich because of the he's very rich, so he's protected or immune. So we have seen many people who are very rich, extremely rich, they could not fight, or they lost their life because of COVID. So I think the understanding of life is one key thing, lessons for me. The second one, which I think, Sheikh, you will really like this one, about the nature. The organization I referred to it earlier, Sustainable Development, World Association for Sustainable Development, we are one of many, many thousands. We've been trying from 1999 for 22 or 23 years to try to convince the whole world or the human being to behave better towards our environment, towards better our earth. Even singers like Michael Jackson had a very famous song about earth, about how we mistreated the earth. We have been badly behaving. Interestingly, when this COVID came, the lots of messages, the campaign, United States, United Nations, tried to bring down issues like climate change, global warming, pollution. I will just give you a few examples. All happened in the last year. For example, many of the statistics are saying that up to one third or even more than one third reduction in pollution across many big cities across the world. So imagine this, many people didn't realize that the pollution rate reduced by more than one third in many big cities. So we are not polluting the environment. Many people, they have many estimates, like the Forbes magazine, they estimated that many lives were saved because we were in lockdown, we were isolating, we were doing all the precaution and the preventive messages we were following from the doctors. So we have managed to save life. Even many people have said, even the number of people who lost their life just to, due to influenza and others is less than the years before COVID, because we are so much careful now, we're having the mask and so on. And interestingly, many of the satellite images of many countries, like in Italy and other European, they are showing that there is a huge reduction in the amount of pollutants across the whole world. So in one side, when we measure air pollution, is being down by one third across many big cities, across many big countries. And then secondly, we have satellite image to prove that the amount of air pollutants on Earth are reduced dramatically. So these are benefits to the whole world. Many people, they didn't realize them. The whole world is fighting to get this one. But one quote I will just read it for you, Sheikh. Very interesting. I was reading a blog for someone called, a chap called Moreno Zogaro. I have never read for him before, but I read this for him last year. And I would just read to you, and then maybe you will reflect on this one. I think you will like this quote from him. He said, "I don't believe in any God, an almighty entity, a higher meaning of life or destiny itself." So he doesn't believe in God or anything, he said. So I definitely wouldn't go as far as saying that this whole thing was brought upon us by a higher force or as a retaliation for what we have done to the planet. And then he went on to say, but it is a pure irony of fate that a country that is responsible for a large part of our environmental issues and pollution gets hit fairest and hard. And I believe he's referring to China. So imagine he started by saying, I don't believe on the act of God, but this is not a coincidence. The country which have the highest pollution and has affected our environment was hit first and hard. Then he went on to say, you need to be nice to Mother Earth and she will be kind to you. And I remember this is one of your key messages last year, Sheikh Babikir, to the kids. You need to be nice to your mother. I remember this very, very well. Because on that day, there's many, many parents were following you. When you remember, you were talking about how kids, they treat their parents. If you remember, this is one of your episodes. Mm. And you were telling kids they have to be very nice to their parents. This is guy saying we need to be nice to the mother earth. And then he went on and he went on. But what is interesting is that people can see there is justice done to the earth for us to be somehow, some way, although he said, I don't believe in God or all any other things, but I believe in God, you believe in God, we believe this is an act. Part of it is to make us to be more disciplined. So I'm not sure what can you reflect or say on this, Sheikh Babikir.
To be honest with you, Dr. Alam, the world is always going to have the two camps. Yani, the human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored them and created them to come onto this earth. Because a question could be asked, okay? If Adam was going to eat from the tree with his wife Hawa, and Shaitan or Iblis will help them and support them to do that, and then they are brought down to earth, why didn't Allah stop it in the first place? But the plan is that people need to understand the knowledge of Allah is beyond the comprehension of the understanding of man. How that come? To explain this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he created the creation, he knows what the creation will do. For example, he created me. But before I was created as a spirit, he knows everything. This human being is going to be doing this. So when people are now living on the earth, they are living on a program that they have chosen themselves and Allah knows about it. There are things, of course, Allah determines for us. Okay? Like, for example, when we are going to be born, which family we'll be born in, what race we are going to have, what language, all this we have got no choice on it. But to live life, to choose faith, is all in our hands. So the world, Allah says, will never come together to all be believers or all be disbelievers. There will always be believers and disbelievers. And that is the real sign there is a choice. Who can choose which direction they want to go. In fact, Allah goes further in the Quran and says, if you look onto the earth at any time, you will find the majority of the people living on it are non-believers. And this is the fact. If there are 7 billion people today in the world, believers who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prophets and the day of judgment and the books of Allah yani are not maybe exceeding, okay? Yani, a third of those people. Why I'm saying this? Maybe there are Muslims by name, maybe there are Christians by name, maybe there are Jews by name, but are they all true believers? Because Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu aminu, all you who believe, do believe. So Iman initially is to submit, just like signing a contract to begin a job. But then the deeds, when you do the work and a report come to say whether you have done well or not. Or when you go to school, you register, but then you attend classes, then you are tested. So this is the idea. This man who wrote this report, it is his choice, and he has the right to say what he says. But my faith and your faith, Dr. Alam, speak differently. We know that nothing takes place without the decree of the Creator Almighty God. Me and you know, you studied management, I studied management, nothing can be done without planning. A small little nursery or a huge big corporation, before they set the work for the year, they will sit down and they will plan and they will write a budget and they will write activities and who to do what and put people to lead. Can somebody believe the whole world is just with nothing and nobody is planning anything, where it will rain, where it will not rain, where there will be a hurricane? And these things, sometimes we see them as evil or bad. Allah said in the Quran, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Perhaps you hear something so badly, but it's good for you. On the contrary, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. Perhaps you love something, it is bad for you. Now, many of us were very angry, very upset that there is lockdown. And many people, I remember at the beginning in America, including leading people, they were walking in demonstration, there is nothing. And then suddenly it dawned in them, there is something there. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the best. And the benefit that will come from this, I promise you, will be long-lasting. Will be long-lasting. As you mentioned it earlier on, one of the easiest things I can pick now, before this lockdown, a sheikh came to London, a very beautiful man called Sheikh Hassan, and he told the people, when you are living in London, a crowded city, most of your journeys are done by the bus or by the tube, and you will go into underground on escalators, in a supermarket, in a department store on escalators, there is a lift. Make sure don't hold and don't touch. This is about almost 15 years ago. He passed away, rahmatullah alayh. Somebody asked him, he said, most of the illnesses you have today, especially the flu, somebody is touching his nose, touching, and you are touching, and you are wiping your mouth, and you are getting. Look, now we came 380 degrees around to know that most of this happened because of touching, breathing, coughing, sneezing. When we used to see people in China or Southeast Asia wearing masks, we used to wonder, why are they wearing masks? As you said, because they had a lot of pollution in cities in the East, like when you go to places in China or places in Indonesia, because of the factories, they can't even see in front of them sometimes. Very, very, very bad, okay? System they were running their countries by. But this reduced the amount of the pollution in the air. They are now getting more healthier. We, as Muslims, believe this is the best thing that has happened to make us retreat and go back a little bit and reflect our purpose. In fact, I will say to people, you should ask yourself, who am I? Am I this physical being I'm looking at in the mirror? Okay, if this is me, so when I am dead, why people put dust on me? I wasn't to be dusted, I'm dirtied by the dust. If I'm dressed in fresh, clean clothes and there is dust, people will wipe it away from me. Sheikh, let me wipe this away from you. But it is there. I'm put in the grave. And people say, you came from the earth, you go back to the earth. We are spiritual beings living in these physical bodies. These physical bodies were created in a womb of a mother, nurtured by that mother. And after 120 days, our souls were put in. The souls of our children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, until eternity, they are alive, living in the spiritual world. They are not aliens. They are real human beings. They don't live where the planets and the galaxies are in this physical world. All this physical world is one world. But beyond that, there are worlds we don't know anything about. We will never be able to reach. For this reason, we need to know, where did we come from? What are we doing here? Where are we going next? What is my purpose of living? And if we realize these things, we can appreciate living and appreciate life. I tell you now, I always tell the younger generation, when you take a rucksack on your back, I take a year off after A levels, or after you finish university, you say to your family, I'm going to travel in Africa or South America with the poor people in India. And I used to meet them in Sudan and welcome them into my home. Some of them are very rich kids, very well-educated kids. And they come just to test life other than the life they are leading. These people, when they go there and they see the life the very poorest are living, with content, no complaint. They have got one shoe and it is broken. They have got one garment and it is ripped. They have got not even a toothbrush. They have got a stick of food brushing the teeth with it. They don't even know where the next meal comes from, but they are saying Alhamdulillah. And here, this rich kid living in France or Germany or Scandinavia or Britain have everything and angry with his parents who are paying his private education for him, angry with the university who's providing the best knowledge for him, angry with his government, and they're producing everything to make life easy for him. When I used to receive them, Dr. Allam, in my country, I used to bring them home. My father, Allah yarhamu, was a very good man. He used to say to me, when you see the strangers, welcome them home. I used to say, Father, some of them are not Muslim. He said, better invite the non-Muslims, because if they don't see the Islamic example in you, where they are going to see it? How? I said to him, give them a bed, give them a shower, give them a meal. And wallahi, I met too many. May Allah bless my dad. And I used to learn, talk a little bit French of them, talk a little bit of English with them, a little bit of German, here and there. And I learned a lot. That's why I came to the West. They made me feel traveling is good. And the Prophet said, Safiru fa inna fi safari manafi'u. Do travel, for indeed in traveling there is benefits. So here, I will say, this professor and his writing, it is answering a lot of good questions. We can't question his relationship with Allah and his faith. For relationships are two. A vertical relationship between you and your creator, and a horizontal relationship between you and the creation. What you do with your creator is between you and the creator. And the Prophet said it clearly. Sallu wan nas niyam. Worship when people are not observing you. Don't show your worship. Okay? This is nonsense. Allah doesn't like showing off. Alladhina hum yura'un. But then yamna'un al-ma'un. Then when it comes to helping people, they are not willing to help. But we are looking at you and looking at your interaction and your relationships. Not just with humans, with animals, with fish, with birds, with the environment in general. And Rasulullah has said plenty about this. So in this sense, I agree with this professor, and this gentleman, whatever he said is true. But when it comes to his relationship with his creator, it is between him, لكم دينكم ولي دين, إن شاء الله.
Sheikh, you touched on two other issues which I think they are also being highlighted by many people. I agree with them totally. There are big benefits or positive lessons learned. Number one, Sheikh, many people have commented saying, despite all the huge work public health have done in terms of making people aware about germs and viruses and to clean your hand, bacteria and all that stuff, the awareness, they said, across the world, as a result of the pandemic or the COVID-19 have increased massively. So now everyone, like you said, he knows he will have to wash his hand. He will have to make sure after he get off the bus, will have to clean his hand. So that in itself is not going to change. We become more aware of these germs, bacteria, viruses, and so on. So that's one also very important positive lessons learned, as you highlighted. The other thing to do with the revolutionary, if you like, discovering an approach in medicine. We all know medicines. We know medicine are there to help us, to protect us, and so on from illnesses. But the belief and the trust in medicine as a medicine has increased, and people now become very much, embedded with any scientific discoveries. And with, because at the start of this pandemic, when people start working for the vaccine, still many people, in fact, I was talking to someone yesterday, did you have the vaccine? He said to me, yes, but my wife did it. She refused. Mm-hmm. And we are now aware that a vaccine which normally take 10 years was done in 10 months. That because of the advancement in technology, which I'm going to mention here now. But also there is an increased, awareness of the benefits of something called telemedicine. In the past, many doctors, and I can maybe quote one here, he went with us to Sudan last year.
Yes, I remember.
At Cambridge, they are doing telemedicine. And now people have seen the benefit of telemedicine during the COVID. My daughter had a doctor appointment, consultation, discussion. Understand, this is also benefit of this lockdown. But if we talk about technology, Sheikh Babikir, this is very important, significant. Technology is there to stay. So this is number one. But people have now, everyone accept, when we've been locked, where did we go? Yes, we went home, but home for us is full of technology. live streaming like what we're doing now. And I will just give you a quote of one example of a company which is many people, they know it. And Zoom. Zoom is a company. It used to be a company, reasonable company, to do with teleconferencing like what we're doing now. In the first quarter of the lockdown, their profit, according to many statistics, they managed to make around £27 million in just the first three quarter of last year.
Allahu
and God. More importantly, interestingly, their CEO, in some quote, in some sources I found, his name is Eric Yuan. He became one of the world's top 100 richest people. Just Allahu imagine, a person who is leading a company, teleconferencing company, In addition to the huge rocketing profit they made from the result of us being locked down all on our computer live streaming, he himself, he made 17 billion share in the company, 17 billion. And he is now, this was recorded back in December, one of the top 100 richest people on the planet. So that's in itself can tell you another lessons about what we are learning, which we have been advocating. Technology is here to stay. Technology is the future of the world in terms of solving our problems. And things like artificial intelligence, data science, now all universities now, all the artificial intelligence, data science. So this is another thing which can also give us an indication. All generations, they have seen it. But just maybe I will just give another point and then I will give you to reflect on this. You mentioned about family earlier, Sheikh Babikir, and there's huge articles I found from last year when I was reading on this COVID benefit. Many people have emphasized on that they didn't know the importance of family until COVID came, which you have said it last year and this year, and you just said it. So many people, they didn't know what is home mean, what is family mean. And here I would like to quote the advertisement of IKEA, you know, the Swedish company.
Yeah.
All the time in the tube, when you are sitting in the tube or everywhere, you will see the advertising saying, after all, or at the end, you go home. That's the IKEA advertisement. Many people, they didn't know what the meaning of that advertisement. What IKEA was trying, because IKEA is giving you ideas for the home, tables, chairs, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Despite after you exhausted, you go to your work and do all that thing, you go home. Home means is everything. Yes. That was the advertisement of a big giant company. Now people understand what is home mean and what is family mean. Many people told me, Alam, I only managed to discover and know better my daughters and sons and wife and husband after I've been locked down with them.
Allahu Akbar.
Many people said that. And I remember there was one of the cartoonics people saying, one of them saying to him, this lockdown, what did you get from the lockdown sitting in the house? He said, I learned my wife better. The other one is about, this is quite important. We never spend many hours together. We never have lunch and dinner together. This is another massive important. And I remember you, I have listened to you, I think in a Jum'ah or one of your talks, you have spoken, I remember in the past, about the importance of family. In everything, not just in people's life, but in everything, family is becoming important. And the other thing in family, I have spoken to many people, loneliness, people start to understand what is the meaning of being lonely.
Yes.
And this also guide me to our parents and old, and I hope, I really pray for them. Allah bless all of our oldest grandfathers, mothers. People, many people, they said to me, some of where care homes to go and see from outside, just my mother or father. So Allah imagine Allah. Now we understand the big lessons. And just to finish that part, I think age.
Yes.
Many people have now started writing about age. In the past, we say, he's an 80 years old. It's not just a number you mentioned. Age got its own attributes. 65 plus, and I'm sure you will be going to give very good perspective here on even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when he say "Amaru ummati ma bayna sittin," this is all give you indication of the age. Now people understand what age means. Age means they are fragile. Age means they need help. Age means they are not going. Even when they become old, This is all to do with age. But now with COVID, we understand what age means really. And also we understand, if you remember also one of your many talks I have listened to, when you are young, you are young, you are fit, make sure you do as much as possible, because as you grow older, you will not be able physically to do it. So COVID told us all this story. And no wonder in all countries, oldest generation are the first to be vaccinated. If you look at even in our country here, the prime minister was just recently vaccinated, I think a month ago or 6 weeks ago. But yeah, oldest generation, they were ahead of everyone because they are fragile. This is the nature of what God told us and prophets and all the sunnah. So I think these are quite important lessons we learn. And I hope, I think we will not forget them, but I think they will open up our mind as a community and and even in Rumi. One of the projects you do, Rumi, you know, you provide food and not only the shelter, but food for those elderly to come together. It's but true. The idea in Rumi, when they come and have that, it's not about the idea of just you are feeding them, but giving them that company to spend together, yes, talking to each other. This is the loneliness the government now realize it's a massive issue in the care sector.
Absolutely, yeah, Dr. Alam. To be honest with you, you spoke about all those things and they remind people of the importance of them to understand. Because in many cases, we listen, but we don't understand. As Allah said in the Quran, وَقَالُوا سَمِعْنَا وَهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ. They said we listened, but they listen not. One of the things that we need to realize, يعني, for me personally, is listening and following the law. For yourself, like us living in a non-Muslim country, following the Islamic law within ourselves in forbidding the evil and acting upon the lawful. This is personal. But other than that, we are responsible to Allah by fulfilling our duty by following the law of the land where we live. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one of his advice to those who made hijrah from Arabia to come to Abyssinia, is that when they get there, every law set by their leaders, they must follow, unless it goes against the Quran or what I taught you, but explain to them why. Hence, when the Mushrikeen came and tried to challenge them in front of Najashi, and Najashi said, they haven't done anything wrong. They're following the law. And when it comes to their worship, that's it, they're personal between them and their creator. I can't challenge them. When they said to the Negus that they were insulting our gods, and he said to them, explain. And Ja'far radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the brother of Ali, explained beautifully when he read Surah Maryam until the Najashi or the Negus started crying. So now we are in similar position, my brother. Our ancestors, me and you, Dr. Alam, and many Sudanese who are listening, or people from the east part of Sudan and Eritrea, Ethiopia, they will understand this. Our people receive some of the best teaching because you welcome people, you look after them, you judge them not, for Allah did not give you the right to judge them. وَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمْ بِمَنَ اتَّقَى. Do not put yourself in a high pedestal and begin to judge others. Allah did not give you that right. You are supposed to judge yourself. حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. You are supposed to be looking after others more than you look after yourself. لَا يُؤْمِنْ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبَّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبْ لِنَفْسِهِ. And from this angle, if you look at the situation now with what is happening to the world and this pandemic, people have learned to put others before themselves. You just gave the example of Rumi scale. People don't realize, although I am sitting at home, I couldn't go out because of my age and I'm locked in, and you are the professor not to go to university and teach from home, and many others work from their home. But do they know that there are people standing in the front lines? People in the supermarkets, people in the hospital and hospices, people in clinics, okay? People who are working in the police, okay, people who are cleaning the roads and carrying the rubbish, all those frontline people, they are putting their life in jeopardy. For whom? For us. And believe me, because we are not going to show them gratitude, and all day around we never show them gratitude. What time do we have to thank the nurses in hospital? But last year, every Thursday, almost everybody stood in front of their home clapping for them. Whether that is beneficial for them or not, but the acknowledgement of that those people have served us, it put us in a better position with Allah. Because He says, you will not be believers until you put others before yourself, until you love for them that which you love for yourself. The human beings, my brother, before this pandemic, were selfish, self-centered, egoistic. Yani, my way or the highway. Nobody is given a chance. There are television programs that will show somebody is being asked, if I employed you in a job, what would you do? How could you make my business better? Well, I know how to lie. I can cheat well. What kind of thing is that? This is not the reality of life. If you look at the innocent people who have not went to school or universities, living in the poorest places in the world, earning their living day by day, the most fundamental thing for them is to be honest and truthful and to be welcoming to their guests. In the Western world where we have everything, before the guests come to us, if the door knocks or the telephone rings, we are worried and frightened. Do you have anything in the fridge? Who is coming? What are they coming for? That person who have a shed, when we, the richer people, go to them, they will give it their bed. They will give it their food. Why? Because they are pure in fitra. They are not being manipulated. They are not being polluted. Our spirits, our souls are being polluted. This is Ramadan. And many of us not realizing the importance of fasting in Ramadan. If not to purify our souls from this pollution of being selfish and self-centered and being evil and being wicked and being and not caring even for your parents, for your wife, or for your husband, or for your children. May Allah reward you, Dr. Alam. When you said, people begin to know, yes, I have a wife, I have a husband, I have children. I want to get to know them. I want to be with them. So we shouldn't take this lightly. The world, although is run by individuals in their own kind of capacity, and then families, and then little groups, and it goes on until governments, and then we have the United Nations on top. But believe me, there is a superior power that runs the world. We are running it from the physical side. They are running it from the spiritual side. Allah said in the Quran, "Kulla yawmin huwa fi shan." Allah every day does something new. I ask myself often, He must be doing every day something different with us. Because He looks at us and He could see there is hopelessness. But He knows by finding just one decent, pure human being, you can do a lot of good.
Allah,
I promise you. I'm going to give you just one thing. I finish with this. Look at that old English man. Okay? The old soldier. I can't remember his name. Was walking with a walking Tom. Who gave him the idea? Why did he, what he did? How much money he raised? There are big charities they will never be able to raise in the time he raised that much money. How much did he raise? A lot of money. He raised millions and millions. And the idea is, Allah has put in his heart, I'm sitting at home, I'm old, I might die at any time, but I have children, grandchildren, I have got people around me, neighbors and friends. Why should they die if they have got life to live? So he started collecting the money, and it is serving whom? Those who are in the front line. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easier for all those who are watching now to begin to understand it is important that we, inshallah, bi-iznillahi ta'ala, begin to think seriously. We are locked down. We are sitting at home. But we are benefiting beyond our comprehension. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَلِجَسَدِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٍّ. And for your body, it has a right over you. وَلِزَوْجِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٍّ. And for your spouse, she has a right or he has a right over you. And وَلِأَوْلَادِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٍّ. If you have children, they have a right over you. And to your employees, they have a right over you. Your neighbors have a right over you. Well, I can go on and on. It's all documented, not just in the scriptures before Islam, but in the Quran, the final book to be revealed, and by the beautiful word of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I will finish this, Dr. Allam, and let you a chance to speak. Look at وَلَجَسَتِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٍ. One of the rights of the body upon us is to clean it by istinja when we go to the toilet, by brushing our teeth, by cutting our nail, and making sure that our hair is well maintained and looked after, by cleaning our body through washing the body, and as Muslim by making wudu every time we need to worship Allah, by making sure that when we go to the bathroom, we make sure that the place is clean. When we walk in the street, we don't throw rubbish. When we find it, it is better. The better of us, the one who picked it up. In fact, it is a sign of a believer. The Prophet said, Al-Iman bid'un wa sab'una daraja. Iman is 70 odd, okay, stages. The lowest of them, imatul adha an al-tariq. When you find something harmful in the street and you take time to pick it up. A skin of a banana. You might say, the foolish one will say, well, I pay my taxes, there is a clean pay to pick it up. But the wise one will say, a child running in front of his mother, pushing a pram, carrying another child, having shopping, her child slips, break his leg, she gets more troubles. Or a blind man, or somebody who's not able to see, pick it up and throw it away. So these are the benefits, Dr. Allam, that inshallah, if we can reflect upon them, our life can become the better, inshallah.
Wallahi, inshallah. What I just remember one example, maybe, I think, because I also, I'm just trying, when I was, things come to my mind, because I listened to you quite a lot of talks and muhadara and khutbah. But one of the, I think the big lessons for me personally, I think many people also I have seen on the internet have also reflected on this, is sharing and caring. Really, this was a message, everyone is agreed to it. And I think I really like many people, I think perspective on this is that you get more people, if you get more love by sharing. The more you share, the more you will get more love, the more you will, we all going to be, if you like, we have a more of a solid together. And I think this was very clearly emphasized during the lockdown. I personally, alhamdulillah, because of my diabetes and asthma, I was being one of those who are called by the government extremely vulnerable people. So we were asked to be locked, shielded. Wallahi, ya Sheikh, and I can remember this very well. And I don't want to mention their names for two reasons. Because one is to, inshallah, increase their ajur for what they have done for me. I know they have done it for many other families. But also because I don't want to forget any single one. During the very difficult time, I mean, now I stopped asking them because it's getting better. But during the very difficult time, I get phone calls regularly. Alam, what do you want? Send us by message. What do you want?
Yeah, salam.
This has three implications. Number one, last year, if you remember, Sheikh, it was extremely difficult. Even as a shield person, when you go online, although you are shield and you should get a priority, still you have to wait up to 3-4 weeks to get a delivery. So the person who is offering to bring you your shopping, he is actually crossing you that even delivery, which the government is trying to help you with. So they're taking this, they're doing this. Number two, they are increasing the risk for themselves. Because for him to go and get you the shopping, he will have to go to Shubber Bush or others. He or she will get exposure more to the virus, to get contaminated. And the chances he is or they will get the COVID, the coronavirus. And I know two of them, they got that virus. Alhamdulillah, they recovered. That itself can give you the quality of one thing. At least you want to be like them. You imagine we want to do as we want to be as close as possible to the Prophet, behaving, the Prophet teaching, everything you keep telling us about how we become a good people. But imagine those are people who are, we know, they are here with us in London, for example. Yes. I asked my wife and many of us said, I would just want to be at least like them, giving myself out to the virus to go and get shopping for someone. You just go and you find it in front of your house. Even when I go and collect it from outside, just at my door, I will come back and I have to do lots of washing. So imagine they were there. But to give you this perspective, this was not just within the Sudanese community. Because I remember someone called me from Brighton, out of Brighton, said to me, Alan, my neighbors, who are older than me, they knock my door and they said, we haven't seen your wife out. Are you okay? Yes. And we said, they are young couples. He said to them, yes, we are okay. Do you want us? We're going to do shopping. Do you want us to bring you something? So it's not just about we all together. It's not about whether we are Sudanese. Yes, we are the Sudanese. We are very proud to be great people together. But I will finish this particular part. You know, the government advise all those who are extremely vulnerable, SHIELD, to call a number, yeah, Sheikh. You call a number, and that number is NHS, the government. And then you say to them, I would like shopping. I would like my medications to be brought from the pharmacy, whatever. And then they will take your postcode because we are all, we can appear on their computer. So the procedure for the government in the last period, they will identify a volunteer who volunteered to help people in his area. So by the postcode, they will identify Sir X who already put himself out to help others. So in my case, I have never used that because I thought, alhamdulillah, I got many people, they wanted to bring me things, my medications is brought to me by friends, my wife sometimes. So I tried to maintain without using the government services. But recently, before we've been allowed to get out, I was late to get one of the medication, and then we couldn't get my wife a lot very well and so on. Then I said, let me try to see how it works. So when I called, they said to me, give us the postcode. I gave them the postcode. He said to me, someone will call you, but please note, this someone will call you from a non-caller ID because this is the way it is. You don't see their numbers, they will bring their medication to you. So I got a call from a lady. She said to me, hello, I'm Alam Ahmed, yes. She said to me, I am one of the volunteers and I would like to bring your medication from the pharmacy. Please give me the address. I told her, where is the pharmacy? It is in Salisbury, blah, blah, blah. And she said to me, I don't know it, but I will find it. Send me the postcode. I gave her the postcode. Then on the day, she went and picked them up. She gave me a call and she said to me, I collected your medication. I'm coming to your place. And I was trying my very best to say thank you. I said to her, okay, I tell you what, you don't need to come to me on the third floor. I will send my daughter, who is 11 years old, to collect it from you downstairs. She said to me, no. I said to her, no, don't worry. My daughter will come down to you. And then I said to her, and this is what I really learned, wallahi, Sheikh. Wallahi is affecting me completely. I said to her, all I know is your name. I don't have your number. And I don't think I will ever going to meet you by any ID because I don't know. The idea is you don't know them. Some people, they will just come and drop you sick. The fact now my daughter will collect it from you, I will not see you. So I wouldn't know how you look like. I wish, I said to her, if I can, I don't want to ask you about your number, but I wish if there is any way I can in the future be able to say to you, thank you and how grateful I am. You know what she said to me, Sheikh? Wallahi al-Azim. Wallahi, Sheikh. She said to me, I am doing this because on my weekend when I'm doing my cycling, I want to use my cycling to help others. And she said to me, I am sure, I don't think she's Muslim because she didn't use inshallah. She said to me, I am sure in the future, you will be helping someone else.
Yes, look at that.
I don't know her, Wallahi, Sheikh. I can't even remember her name. I haven't seen her. My daughter saw her. So she said to me, no, don't worry. In the future, you will be helping someone else. So this is a cycle of sharing, of being good to everyone. And I think because of the time, I will finish with one very important point, I think benefit. And I really want, I thought it might be good. And I can see the time is passing us. And always, it's a pleasure to talk to you, Sheikh. It's about women. You have talked a lot about women and you have talked about the role of women in Islam and what they are doing. And I have listened to many, many talks from you. But one important thing, what I think me and many, many others, particularly those of us, maybe Sudanese or others, it is indescribable. You can't describe in every household what women have done. I think whatever I have done or any of my other household have done, there is no way you can even put them, compare and contrast when we do the research. You cannot compare. If you look to your wife or mother or sister, any one of us, and just calculate from last February to now, we're still in lockdown. I'm sure you know that. Just for this 1 year, I think in every house, many of my friends told me, Alam, we are not eating one meal or like before COVID or two meals. Now we are eating maybe four or five meals. There's so many snacks during the night, particularly when the kids are not going to school. Who is doing all that? Is the wives, is the mother and the sister. They're not doing a normal if you like feeding us, but they are doing it 3-4 times.
Allahu
how many coffee tea, those who are coffee drinkers, it's not once or twice, it's plenty, maybe 40, 30 times. I'm not exaggerating. Some people let me out, I'm tea and coffee is going like the whole day from the time we woke up until we sleep.
Yeah.
Watching who is, and again, they are the one who is comforting with. So I think the role of women, people, I think we all know how important are, how we're grateful to our women generally, whether they're sisters, wives, or mothers. But I think this COVID gave people the opportunity to see it by their eyes. What would have happened? And I, many times I would say to my wife, if any one of us catch it, I hope it is me, because she said to me, no, you are the one who is important with the family. I said to her, no, if I am gone, I am gone. Allah.
You,
many people, they don't realize who is important in this house. And I think women, they now know that they are the most important human creature in that house.
Yes.
But finally, what COVID have told us, and I think many of my colleagues across the world, many women leaders, I have spoken to them in our network, they all confirm COVID gave women across, particularly the Middle East, and across the world, the opportunity to see by themselves that they can work even if they are sitting at home.
It's true.
From home, everything is happening in home. This computer, Sheikh, wallahi, it is the same computer I use for teaching, for talking conference, the same, everything. Except now when my wife, this is actually my wife, she said, because we are locked, let's decorate the house so our daughters can understand what is Ramadan. Everything, they do it. So I just sit. So now women, or all of us in society, understand fully, how can we help ourselves and our community and our household and our women to work? Because now COVID told everyone, work can happen from every place. And this every place includes the house where most women, not necessarily Sudanese or Arab or Muslim, many women I know from different other cultures, they are from at home for whatever the history of our culture. But this is an opportunity now. We have seen it by our eyes. So I think maybe the strongest message we can leave, or when we get out of COVID, that there is a big opportunity to get our women to have a chance to help them at least to do work from home. They can make millions of pounds. And we have seen it. There's many people who have sold in Amazon from home. They haven't left the house. They made millions. So sorry, I talked too long here.
No.
I thought I will conclude with this.
No, inshallah. But to be honest with you, the point you mentioned about women is a very important point. And in fact, a lesson can be learned, because sometimes the kids and the father leave early to go to their work or to their education, whatever they are doing, but they don't realize that everything that takes place to make a home function is carried by a mother, as you said, or an older sister or a grandmother sitting at home. And by the way, this is not really to do with any culture. This is to do with the whole world. I remember when I came to Britain, I have a colleague studying with me in English from a middle class family. Yani, he will not lift a cup to put it in the sink. Everything is done by his mother, his shirt, his button. And I used to do my own thing. So I used to say to him, what is this? He said to me, it's her job. I said to him, who gave her that job? I said, her job is to nurture you from the day you are born until you are able to look after yourself as a child. After that, the home duties is a shared business. And the best example can be given from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the eunuch, who said, خيركم خيركم لأهلي. The best of you is the one who is best to his family. And in the seerah, كان الرسول الله سلم يخدم أهله. He وسلم, used to serve. I have seen my father, I've seen my brother-in-law, I've seen my brother. When there is something to be done, we all share, we all help. Yes, maybe they are leading in it because they know it, and they help us in what we do as well. So in that sense, I think this can be a lesson for everybody watching to realize that women, for a long time, they have been not given the opportunity to be able to be treated properly. And it's still happening, even in the most advanced countries. Not equal in payment, not equal in given responsibilities. And this is all nonsense. And to me, this is, it has got no place in faith. It has got no place in humanity. After all, if not for the women, we will not be sitting here. And the Prophet said, Ummuka, thumma ummuka, thumma ummuka, your mother, your mother, your mother. 75% of your love and devotion should go, oh human, to your mother. Then 25% to your father. Yes, your father go out and work and earn, but today, look how many women are working, and in many cases, men are sitting and women are working. So I need people to understand. Please don't take this lightly. This COVID business is real. There are people who don't believe in it, and it's nonsense. It's nonsense because it is there. It's a disease. And if you are saying Allah cannot create disease, okay? When Ebola took place in Africa, the same thing, and they cut West Africa. Okay, when cholera takes place, they do the same thing. And 2 years ago, I went to Tanzania for a visit, 3 years ago. They asked me for vaccine, a passport vaccine for cholera and for something else I can't remember. I had to go to a doctor and get it done and got my passport, and I have to enter Tanzania. Now, if you don't get this vaccine and get your passport, you will not be able to travel soon because people are frightened because you spread the disease. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when there is a pandemic, if you are in a place where it is, stay. And if you know there is a place in it, don't go to it. So somebody say, I don't believe in it. It's nonsense. This is all coming from shaitan, because shaitan tries to put you off the path of making sure that Allah does. فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ, Allah said in the Quran. Allah does what He wants. What Allah wants? To bring us back, to make us realize. Clean yourself. Care for one another. Look after yourself properly. Be a little bit merciful. Be kind. Look after your environment. Alhamdulillah, everything is happening. And inshallah, in the future, it will happen. Before we finish, Dr. Allam, Jazakallah al-Fakhir for this. And I'm so grateful to you. I remember once you told me, and you said something absolutely amazing. Because people don't understand the concept of giving. One of the most important side of the human being that will benefit them here and hereafter is to give. A lot of people think giving is giving money. Money is good to give if you have it. But if you don't have it, what can you give? You can give. You can give your time. You can give your energy. You can give your strength. You can give your knowledge, your expertise. Okay, and that's all fantastic. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, even to those who are too stingy to give, مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرُضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا فَيُضَعِفُهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا. Who will give Allah a goodly loan? Allah will multiply it many times over. No business in the world can give you many multiples as a prophet. Now, one of the things that I think a lot of communities misunderstand is volunteering. And in this pandemic, believe me, volunteering became essential for an organization like Rumi's, who are in the front line helping to feed, okay, the homeless, shelter them sometimes in our buildings, and making sure that they get their medications and their cleaning stuff like toothpaste and soap and some fresh clothes, and making sure that they are fed properly, and going out to the elderly in the community and visiting them, giving them time, okay, making sure that those who come to collect from the food bank, everything is organized for them properly. That is requiring time and energy from people, and we had volunteers. And subhanAllah, look at the benefit. Because those volunteers gave their time to come and help us, some of them are young. When I question the authorities, why don't you vaccinate them? Because they are in danger. Guess our local authority immediately wrote to us, said, yes, it has to be done. And it was done. I had about 30, 40 of them all vaccinated. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Twice. And they're safe because they gave, Allah gave them back. Rasulullah says, خير الناس من ينفع الناس. The best of people is the one who benefit people. When الناس بالناس ومن يعين يعن. And people are always in need of one another. But only those who help will be helped. You said to me, because of the knowledge you have, especially in subject that you have trained, and you are training people across the world, for the sake of your mother, to do something charitable, you want to create a platform to give maybe a 3 days course whereby, mashallah, when you do it, a lot of money is paid, but for free. And through our organization, talking to my staff, they are willing. So now people are listening. Whosoever want to do the course, and you can explain what course it is, how long it will take, what should they do to register? When are you going to be able to do it? Shall we wait until this is lifted and people can come to you? Can it be done now through the... Whatever you think, inshallah. Bismillah.
والله يا شيخ يعني you just beaten me for it. شكرا جزيلا يا شيخ. First of all يا شيخ والله أنا يعني I've been receiving many many phone calls of the great way كرومي. I know in Arabic and Sudanese they say شهادتي مجروحة, ولكن let's say in English يعني is one of the few places والله أنا have been in this country for nearly 30 years. I lived in many places. In Edinburgh, in Gloucester, in Siren Sister, in London, in Brighton. I really moved. Like in one of the places, wallahi, يعني I'm telling you this, and I'm, alhamdulillah, I'm fasting even with my diabetes now. Alhamdulillah. Wallahi is truly and faithfully, I say this, one of the places when I enter that place, Rumi Cave. That's why I'm really looking forward. Inshallah, when this restriction are lifted, I will walk into that place. Wallahi, I always, even my daughter said the same. You feel really that love we talk about. Very relaxing environment. Wallahi, this is very difficult to find. Even in my own office when I go to the university, I don't feel I am getting into. And I really encourage those in London or outside London to visit Rumi when these things will happen. According to the Prime Minister, 21st of June, he said he will lift everything. So number one. Number two, the work you do is really great. All the people there, I'm really impressed. All of them, Amina, and all of them, all the people there. It's a great work done there. It's very nice atmosphere. It's very useful, and it's giving to the community. I just want to even maybe emphasize on what you have said. Whatever Allah يعني, gifted me, I'm not saying I'm smart, but there are things I know I have been doing. And people ask me to deliver. And I won't talk about them now, but my website is there. Anyone can go to my website. If Amina is watching us now, she can put the website here. It's alamahmad.org. It's very easy. Alamahmad, all one word, .org or .com. Any training I normally do outside my university full-time teaching, and people, they pay money to attend it. Anything you feel I can do it, or if I can't do it, if you send me and say to me, Alam, I'm interested, I know many people, I don't speak of them, but many, many experts, better than me, in areas like public health, even in virology, in areas like, my best areas is like leadership, management, all these things I know very well, performance indicators, I can help organizations to transform. Anything you think I can be of use to you, formal training with certificates, wallahi al-azim, all you need to do, just contact me, we will organize it. All I will ask you, just donate whatever part of what you could have paid for me to Rumi Cave. That's all I want. I really want to do this like the girl who told you before, you remember? She said to me, I know, Alam, next time you will have a chance to help others. And I'm not here helping Rumi Cave. I'm helping lots of humanity. A Sheikh Rich is huge. Wallahi, it's true. I say this. I get feedback, comments from all over the world. In front of me now, I can see Dr. Dima Dejani. She is joining us from Jordan. I know her. She's one of our colleagues, a distinguished academics in Jordan. I have seen here before. I remember As-Siddiq Farjallah. I know he's from Sudan. I think so. So there's many people who are benefiting, are really, really asking, can a Sheikh come? Even this year. I told the Sheikh, but the Sheikh is very busy. He couldn't get him to do it. But I know Sheikh, he never stopped short. Tomorrow he's giving a talk to the Nubian community. But the benefit of what is being done in this room when it is open is unbelievable. And I really encourage any event, anything you do, anything, just look to their website. They are well organized. But from my side, not only me, if there is any of my colleagues, I know many colleagues in different disciplines, not necessarily in my management field, I will ask them, and I am quite confident. No single one of them will stop short of giving for you to give back to the Rumi Cave. So please look at this. As the Sheikh said, if it's something we can do online, we have trained people online many times. We can do it. We know how to do it, number one. Number two, if, inshallah, things are lifted, or if I travel many times to give training in Bahrain, in Saudi, in Sudan, in many, many places, even if I will to travel or to train people, and then the reward, the financial part of that, to go to Rumi, wallahi, I don't even need to know what Rumi will do with it, because they can choose anything. Wallahi, anything. Wallahi al-azim. Anything Rumi will do, wallahi, is more satisfactory to me. If they do it for teaching Quran, if they feed the elderly, if they make that atmosphere of people, you can see people loving, just to make those elderly people to have to break their loneliness, wallahi, I don't need to know what the money is being used for. And that's the beauty of Deen. And I really, really want people to go to Romy Cave and see what they're doing. The website is full, but I really, really look forward, inshallah, after this COVID, يعني, all those who have been watching, following from last year, Sheikh, you have done remarkable last year,
alhamdulillah,
to really contribute. And yes, maybe you can't come and volunteer like a Sheikh, but I always say to people, there is always the same like al-Iman, as-as-af al-Iman bil-ghalb. It is the least you can do, maybe donate money. And also don't forget, $5 is not like it's equivalent to a couple of millions in countries like Sudan. Whatever you do, do it. Even if you are countries, so some people very rich in other countries, Romy's.org. So yes, and I would like also to encourage all my colleagues, the professionals. We have many, many of them. And I know they are listening, they are following. Contact me, and if you want to even add your workshop or your courses in my website, I will add it. Anyone doing anything, medicine, helping with English, but we will do everything to make it available. Anyone in Sudan, in America, in Saudi, in Bahrain, here in this country, why not we help anyone want to be trained in the UK? We will come to the room, we'll give proper training, we'll give you a certificate. And then you donate, let's call it not fees, but we call it a donation. You just pay that money because some of the courses, imagine they cost $10,000. If you pay $2,000, I would be very happy. Not because I have paid Romy money, but I have helped in some other people. Romy is going to help them. So please, please do your best, particularly Ramadan. And if there is anything you need to know, I think there is lots of information. And I really can't tell you, just maybe to finish with the summer, with one positive thing about youngest. I have two daughters who used to go to the Romy, Shahad and Lena. Lena is always saying to me, I like the place because they particularly Rakin. I don't know, many of you may not know Rakin, but many that you know Rakin. Rakin is one example I always give about Romy, one example. This man is smiling all the time. Allah bless him. I have never seen Rakin not smiling. Wallahi, I wish, even when I do talk or I speak in TV, sometimes my wife said to me, why are you not smiling? Wallahi, I wish I always smile like Rakin, number one. Number two, he's so humble and kind to these kids. He's a teacher. He's leading Islam. But what Rakin was doing with the kids, even to the extent I said to him, I want you to give us a course, not the kids. He's teaching them. He's using the rap music, so they can recite Quran and Hadith and Sunnah. Wallahi, it's a pleasure. You ask him to listen. Even I said to him, I would like you to organize the course. Tell us what is rap. The rap music, how you use it. He's just clever, this man. Is a kind of creativity in that place. My daughter, every time, said to me in the train, when we go to the Romy to go for the classes, she was reading for me and they start doing the things. So this is this place. Wallahi, Sheikh, yani the spirit you create in that
Wallahi,
place.
Jazakallah, Dr. Allah.
Wallahi, is unbelievable. So let's help this place because it helps us. It helps me, as my daughters, and it helps people in Sudan. And I just finished, Sheikh. I know I may speak for hours, but we've been abroad before, and I can say this. Maybe Asia, Miss Asia is listening to us from Sudan. Asia is leading an NGO, I think it's funded by the USAID or something, in Sudan to try to fight against these rumors, you know, the misinformation about COVID and so on. She approached me, and I don't think she will mind me saying this public. Imagine this is an international organization in the country, said to me, Allami, we know that you are close contact with Sheikh Babikir. Can you organize for us, Sheikh Babikir, to give a talk to sheikhs in Sudan to try to push the message of them helping us in combating COVID-19? Can you see the impact like this? This is, if you do it at universities, you will become a professor, because this is the impact. To become a professor, you need to have an impact, not just writing papers. Wallahi, this is true. Her name is Asia. It's a big organization. One day we have the Zoom. They want Sheikh to talk because of the way Sheikh is so simple in his message. Alhamdulillah, is a gift Allah gave him.
Alhamdulillah.
In terms of how to make this. And one important thing many people said here, and I know I don't want to mention English names here, they like the Sheikh understanding of the different faces. A Sheikh is not discriminating between Muslim or non-Muslim. He is a gluing. Sheikh Masih is always about we all here together. And this is what COVID, we all here together. Black, white, Christian, Muslim, non-Muslim. I said to my wife the other day, I got vaccinated before my prime minister. Wallahi, no more adala than this. I vaccinated before the prime minister. Is this happening in some countries, in our developing countries? No. The priority, I got ahead of my prime minister because I am extremely vulnerable person. So I got a priority. This is what the Sheikh approach. So let's advance this message. Yeah. Wallahi, I'm really sorry if I talk, but I really thank you very much, Sheikh, for all your work. Yani, on behalf of anyone who you have contributed, I have so, and I'm really looking forward to see the opening of this country in June, so we can all come and rebuilding what you have done there, but continuing what is being done in Romania.
We have got good plans once everything is lifted, and in fact we'll begin with a very big inshallah comedy show from one of the greatest comedians. I can't remember his name, but if Amina hear me, can put his name on the screen. This comedian came to a night of remembrance for one of his friends, who is also a very close friend of mine, Rahmatullahi Alayh. He used to come every Friday, bring his own food he cooked by himself with his children, and put the food and feed students. They used to be coming from America, Christian or Jewish student visiting England to study certain aspects about this country. And this guy, when we did this gathering, he's called Umar Jalili. It is written there. Umayyad Jalili, very famous actor. I spoke about my friend in a way whereby when he came to speak, he said, "You took everything I want to say, and you make me laugh. I'm a comedian. You shouldn't make people laugh." And then he said to me, "Look, what you do is fantastic. I want to help." So now he agreed, inshallah, by the end of August, he's going to do a big show for us, and we're going to raise funds to help those people who are helping the vulnerable in this country, inshallah, through Rumi's Cave. And I hope, inshallah, everybody listening will look into rumiscave.org and find, inshallah, the advert for that and register your name for interest to come with us. And inshallah, for those who are not with us in this country, who are abroad, we will put it for them to see it, inshallah, through the medium you have, Dr. Allam and others. So, inshallah, because at the end of the day, the world is one. And this dunya is only a phase through which we are traveling. The Prophet said, live in this world as if you are a stranger. A stranger. Tomorrow is a different day. This life is not forever, but the hereafter is that which is forever. If we can love one another, care for one another, forgive one another, accept one another, lift up those who are beneath us. Don't be envious of those who are above us. All the time, put in your heart that you want to do good, because Allah looks into your heart. Don't let your heart ever have any whispers about plotting evil or thinking bad about others, because at the end of the day, inna ba'da dhanni ismun, some of these suspicions within the heart are sinful. And therefore, I hope and I pray, bi'iznillahi ta'ala, Dr. Allam, through you and your organization and all those who are listening, we can do better in this world. I always say to myself, my children, my family, those students around me, if any non-Muslim is asking me, the Prophet is the final Prophet and he brought the message, the final message, he didn't deliver it to me. I have an answer for him. I am here representing him. But if I am here representing him, but I am not behaving like him, how can he accept what I am saying? And what was his description? As-Sadiq, Al-Ameen, the truthful, okay, the honest, Al-Kareem, okay, Al-Jawad, the generous, the most helpful. He's always there for people. And inshallah, I want to get those children who are growing up in these difficult days, inshallah, to have a future. May Allah bless you, Dr. Allam, and all those people. And make a dua, and then we'll finish, inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد المبعوث رحمة للعالمين الهادي إلى الصراط المستقيم الذي أتيته السبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم بأي القرآن الذي أنزلته على قلبه الرحيم إلا ما نظرت إلينا يا ربنا في هذه الساعة بنظرة رحمة من عندك، اجعلنا بها من عبيدك الذين إذا نظرت إليهم سكن غضبك يا كريم، واغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وكن عولا لنا. ونسألك اللهم بنبيك المختار وآله الأخيار يا ربنا كفر عنا الذنوب والأوزار، وادخلنا اللهم الجنة مع الأبرار. ونتوسل لك بنبيك المصطفى وآله أهل الصدق والوفا يا ربنا كلنا معينا ومزعفا، وبوئنا يا ربنا من الجنة غرفا. اللهم إنا نسألك سلطانا نصيرا وحظا عظيما وأجرا وفيرا وتجارة لن تبور، وفقنا توفيقا مطلقا، وارزقنا حلالا طيبا واسعا بلا كد يا ربنا، استجب دعاءنا بلا رد، وآتنا كلمة لا ترد، وادخلنا الجنة بغير حساب. اللهم إنا نسألك سؤال مضطر محتاج إليك إلا ما رفعت هذا البلاء عن العالم، وجعلت الذين هم في المستشفيات من المرضى أو في البيوت من الذين سيشفون في هذا اليوم قبل غد يا كريم، واشفنا وعافنا وارفع ما بنا يا أرحم الراحمين. طهر ألسنتنا من الكذب وقلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وأبصارنا من الخيانة، فإنك تعلم خيانة العين وتخفى الصدور. ربنا تقبل منا صيامنا وقيامنا وركوعنا وسجودنا وذكرنا وشكرنا وتلاوتنا للقرآن. اللهم ربي أيدنا بعندك وما عندك يا كريم، اللهم يا ربي أيدنا بما عندك يا كريم، واجعلنا من عبيدك المؤيدين المنصورين حيثما كانوا يا أرحم الراحمين. I ask Allah to forgive all our sins, to erase all our bad deeds, to exchange them to good deeds, and to multiply them to an infinite number, to raise us among the righteous in the day of judgment, to greet us with his greeting of peace, تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام, and to allow us to dwell in his garden, the garden of peace. ادخلوها بسلام آمنين. May he allow us and call us to enter it in peace and to dwell in it in peace. With Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. May he allow us to drink from his blessed right hand, from Al-Kawthar, a drink that we will never be thirsty thereafter, Ya Kareem. May Allah heal all those who are sick, and may Allah protect all those who are healthy. May Allah allow the people to understand and appreciate nothing will take place in this world without his permission. For it is he, Allah, who decreed everything. And it is he, Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, without him nothing will be carried, nothing will be done. Allahumma ahfadna waqifin, wa ahfadna qa'idin, wa ahfadna na'imin, wa ahfadna fi kullu lahzatin wa hin, bi ithmika al-hafidhu ya hafidhu, ya hafidhu, ya hafidhu. واغفر لكل من انتقل من أسرنا أبائنا وأمهاتنا وأجدادنا وأعمامنا وخلاننا وخالاتنا وأعمامنا وعماتنا وذوي القرابة منا وللفقراء والمساكين ولسائر المسلمين. صلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمين وآله وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. جزاكم الله ألف خير. فتح الله عليكم دكتور علام and everybody إن شاء الله and we will see you soon بإذن الله تعالى
إن شاء الله.
السلام عليكم.